Well, welcome. I think this is a timely conversation to have. I was thinking back, and I'll introduce our panelists in just a second, but I want to set the stage a little bit. Looking back historically, I think we had a time in our history where often we were focused most on our middle and high-performing students. And then our pendulum swung, as it usually does in education, pretty dramatically, and rightfully, in my opinion, focused on our lowest performing students, often those who had been left behind. I think we had a law that passed that captured that point. And I think we're here today, as I look at what's happening in education, we have over 40 states who have adopted higher standards and assessments to align with those standards, with a commitment to close what I would call the honesty gap around how our students are really doing. And I think that is absolutely a necessary step to have the conversation about, the honest conversation about, how is every single student doing, not just a low performer, not just a high performer, but every single student. But as I said, we have spent a fair amount of time over the last 20 years truly focused more on our low performing students. And it is high time we ask some tough questions about how we're serving our high-performing students. What are we doing? How are we challenging them? Are they truly competitive? Or have we just said, hey, they seem pretty good, so let's keep moving. And I would say that as a general rule, we have said they're doing pretty good, let's keep moving. And I think each panelist here today has some provocative questions they've asked when it comes to serving every single student. And so I'm excited to hear from them and want to introduce you. I think what we will do is have each panelist present for about 5 to 10 minutes. And then I will ask some questions of the panelists, and then we'll open up for the audience. So very quickly, we have esteemed panelists across the board. I'll start with Dr. Checker Finn. He is President Emeritus of the Thomas B. Fordham Institute, where he serves as a Distinguished Senior Fellow. He also, and this is actually where I met Dr. Finn at the Hoover Institution as a senior fellow there, has written prolifically on many topics as well as spoken on many topics. So we're proud to have Dr. Finn, and he will actually go last. I'll go in reverse order as far as introductions. We also have Erik Fresen. He is a representative from Florida, has served since 2008, and from what I see, has served in almost every capacity related to education when it comes to the representation, whether it's appropriations or policy. So we're excited to hear what's happening in Florida in regards to challenging our students. Dr. Jonathan Plucker, currently the Endowed Professor of Education at the University of Connecticut, soon moving to Johns Hopkins University, actually in January. So exciting, and look forward to hearing your comments. And last but certainly not least, Dr. Theokas from Ed Trust has spent quite a bit of time analyzing and looking at what are the achievement gaps we see, not just low-performing students to high-performing students, but actually around our high-performing students, what are we seeing? So really important conversation, and we'll look forward to getting started right now and hearing from our distinguished panelists. So Dr. Theokas.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's really nice to be here and nice to see so many people in the room wanting to hear and talk about and discuss with us about how we can move more students to higher levels of achievement. As Dr. Skandera said, this has not been a real discussion that's been happening in lots of places, but it's emerging and it's becoming a bigger conversation, so I'm glad so many people are here to talk about it with us. More often than not, the achievement gap is thought of as the difference between low-performing students, often low-income students and students of color, and the students who are proficient, getting them over that bar to proficiency, and that's where the gap exists. But the reality is the gap exists along the achievement continuum. And my role on the panel is to ground us in the data and to start a conversation how we can continue to raise the floor, because we do still need to raise the floor for all kids, but also how we can move middle and high achievers even further, faster. So I'm going to jump in and show you a bunch of data slides, and those of you who know the Ed Trust know we love data, and we can't hide from it, so I'm going to show that to you. So right now, I'm going to start with data from the National Assessment of Educational Progress, and I'm going to show fourth grade math as an example. example. And I'm using fourth grade math, but please know that the trends are similar for fourth grade reading and eighth grade reading and math. So if we look over the last decade, you can see that progress has really occurred at the low end. We said we wanted to make a change there. We have made a change there. The gaps between groups of students have decreased by about 7 percentage points over the last decade. If we break the groups of students out by race and ethnicity and free and reduced lunch status, we see the same trend whether you're free and reduced lunch eligible or not free and reduced lunch eligible. So again, about a 7 to 8 point decrease in the gap between groups of students regardless of their poverty status. If we look at the proficient level, again, we've been really trying to focus on getting kids to this level, and you can see over the last decade we have made progress. Here, all groups of students have been making progress, but we have not been closing the gap that separated Black and Latino students from their white peers. But when we go and look at the high end and we look at the last decade, we see that some students have been making progress where other students have been stagnating and not making any progress. So here you can see that the gap between white students and their Black and Latino counterparts has grown over the last decade. So someplace where we haven't been paying attention, we're seeing a change happening and only some students are making progress. And then when you break this group of students out, at between free and reduced lunch students and non-free and reduced lunch students, you actually see where the gap has been growing most is between middle income African American and Latino students and their white peers. So the white, more affluent students have been making quite a bit of progress. And this sort of defies the idea that, well, the reason that we didn't see the same progress for Black and Latino students was because of poverty. This really shows us that's not the case, where we see overall, generally, low-income white students performing at about the same percentage as higher-income African-American and Latino students. I don't want to say that we haven't been making any progress at Advanced. The green lines on this graph show students at the 90th percentile, and you can see over the last decade those scores have been ticking up, but for African American and Latino students they haven't hit into the Advanced range. We've also been making progress at the 10th percentile, you can see that there as well. But this doesn't mean we've solved the problem at the low end. And you can see here with this graph on the low end gap, the gap at the 10th percentile is actually larger between students than the gap at the high end. Now I want to transition real quick to 12th grade. At 12th grade, I'm not even showing the percentage of kids getting to Advanced because there are so few students who get there and there's been very little change over the last decade. The interesting thing about the 12th grade data compared to the 4th and 8th grade data is that the gap at the 90th percentile is larger than the gap at the 10th percentile. And if you look at this graph, I know I've been running through them really quickly, you actually can see that the 90th percentile students for Black and Latino students are barely at the top of the basic level, and for white students, the 90th percentile students aren't at Advanced. So I think the reason the gap is so much bigger at the top is there's just a lot of distance still left to go, and we need to make a lot of progress there. So I think the argument that I want to make to kind of get us started with is our focus on proficiency is not enough. But neither is advanced learning opportunities for just some students. That's not going to close the achievement gap, and it's not going to close the achievement gap at the high end either. So what I'm thinking is that it's time for a mindset change with associated practice and policy change that supports talent development and focuses on equity and outcomes. So I think what we want to be talking about now is that all students deserve to be challenged and all students need growth. And those are the things to keep in mind as we think about what effective policies and practices might be. So I thought what might be helpful is to give an example of a school that's really hitting it out of the park in that mindset change and getting students to advance. So the graph on the right shows that fifth grade math, the percentage of students overall, Latino and low income, who are achieving advanced on their state test, and that's about 25% for all groups of students. There's a quote from the principal, and she says, it's all about growth. If you stop thinking that way, watch out. Some people think if it ain't broke, But you can always grow, and it's our job to challenge students. So what they do is, I think the key characteristic of their school is they use flexible grouping and regrouping, and it's a responsive grouping that's happening. It's not like you get grouped at the beginning of the year with a group of students and you stay with them throughout the year. But they get grouped based on subject and grade, and those groups, as kids make progress and master things, shift and move around over the course of the year. So it's very responsive to students. Students are learning with peers who are at a similar level to them, and it's actually not bound by grade. They will have kids who are, for example, third graders who are working at a fifth grade level who are going to be grouped with fifth grade students. So it's a very fluid and flexible environment, and it's focused on growth and mastery for the students. And they talk about, the first thing they do is they identify their intervention groups, because they know so many of their students are coming in, they're first generation kids, many of the students are still learning English, it's about 50%. So they identify those intervention groups first because they know they need to get those kids moving really fast and on a good growth trajectory. But they also identify gifted students right at the beginning as well. They don't use a single indicator for giftedness. They look for ability, they look for motivation, they look for creativity. So because they know all students have unique abilities and they want to capitalize on the potential of all of the students that they have. And I think I'll just say one thing really quick. One of the really nice practices that they do at the school is that early on in the school year, every staff member is responsible for a student in the school. So each student in the school has a staff member who speaks for them, and they stand up at a staff meeting and they talk about that student and what that student's strength is, and they sort of continue that throughout the year. So I do want to say the school also has a gifted teacher. That teacher is paid through Title I funds. People think Title I is really just for low-performing students, but they're using those funds to support a gifted teacher. She teaches advanced classes, but she also provides instructions to the other teachers on the pedagogy that she uses in advanced classes, so kids benefit from those types of strategies in terms of taking more ownership for their learning, pacing their learning, and doing lots and lots of writing, so it's a lot about autonomy. I think I'm just about out of time, so just going to say that there are some district strategies as well. The district challenge is to bring that opportunity for rigor to scale across all schools in a district, ensuring equal access for kids. And there's a number of strategies that the districts can take and are taking, and there are associated state actions to go along with that, but we can talk more about those in the conversation after everyone gets to go. So I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Jonathan Plucker.
Thank you, Christina. So while we're waiting, I think I remember what my slides were. A little background. I have to say, it is really a little background. I wasn't kidding. I literally meant I had memorized the first slide. I have to say, as someone who has been beating this drum about the fact that policymakers within education need to be focusing on excellence as well as basic proficiency. 7 or 8 years ago, it was a really lonely drum that I was beating. I would have been the only one up here, to be frank, and none of you would have been there. So the fact that this is actually starting to become an important national policy topic is very rewarding. But as we were all talking about before, there is so much work that has to be done. I think we have a good grasp of the nature of the problem, as you just saw. I'm going to give you a little bit more on that. But it really becomes we need to buckle down and start to solve this problem and shrink these excellence gaps. So before I jump into the report that I'm going to talk about, I don't know if any of you were in the PISA session before. Many of the speakers kind of talked about how internationally U.S. students at the top end didn't compare very well. These are the data that they're talking about. This specifically is TIMSS. This is grade 4 and grade 8 math. Science looks almost exactly the same, except grade 4 science were actually closer to the top in terms of the percent of advanced performers. And then in grade 8, we drop. And then PISA is 15-year-olds. It shows that it's much, much, much lower. So the same basic trend. There are huge state and regional variations in the percentage of students who score advanced. So I'm going to quickly run through these because I don't have a lot of time. But traditional stoplight color, you want your state to be green. Dark red, probably not fantastic. Grade 4 math, grade 8 math, that's actually better. A lot less red, a lot more yellow. Grade 4 reading, again, not bad in most states. Grade 8 reading. In case you didn't notice the difference between those last two, grade 4 reading, grade 8 reading. Yikes. Excellence gaps are actually smaller in grade 8 reading because the top performs so much lower, the top groups, which I would argue is a very American way to solve that problem, but that's a whole other discussion. You've already seen Christina's graph of this. That's not bad. Our less economically vulnerable students, about 4 to 5 times as many scoring advance over the past roughly 19 to 20 years. That is real progress. That is real progress. The bottom line is not real progress. It's not real progress at all. Absolutely. People often ask, why do you just look at math and reading? Those are actually the happy stories. This is science. Those are zeros. Not good news. So whenever I hear people say, look, those kids can take care of themselves. I was on the phone not 2 hours ago with the education aide from a certain governor who said that to us at the end of the conversation. We thought we had convinced her this was important. And she goes, well, you know, in the end, those kids can take care of themselves. And I almost jumped out of the window. My response to that usually is, well, yeah, I guess they can, except that all the data says that they're not. So other than all of the data, you are totally right. So we can predict with reasonable accuracy that any talented student who fits those groups, if they're talented in third or fourth grade, I can almost guarantee you that they will not be performing at advanced levels by the time they get to middle school, let alone high school, and certainly not college. Not a happy story. We've been calling it a persistent talent underclass, which I know is strong language because it's a big problem. It's a big problem. So the Jack Kent Cook Foundation came to us about a year ago and said, hey, recently you said that we should be going state by state and evaluating their policies. I was like, yeah, I said that. And they were like, well, can you do it? And I said, awesome, give me money to do it. And they said, yeah. And I was like, great, like 2017? And they said, no, in 2 months. So we worked really hard to look state by state. I'm going to breeze through this pretty quickly. We believe that much of it is an awareness problem. When we meet with governors, when we meet with state school chiefs, when we meet with education committee chairs, they're usually surprised at their state's data. And their next question is, what can we start doing about this? So we think it's mostly an awareness issue. Enough about that. We went out, we put a great advisory board together, state school chiefs, to classroom teachers, data people, professors, to come up with the best set of indicators to go state by state. They came up with about 3,000 indicators, of which we could not use. We classified them into policies on the front side, who's actually using the policies, and then outcomes. And this is roughly what it looked like when we actually tried to find the data. That's enough. When we actually went to go look at student participation data, it was shocking how hard it was to find participation data. So that's my best Richard Dawson Family Feud. And I'm very much a Richard Dawson Family Feud person. The others are imposters. Let's just agree. A lot of nodding heads. We gathered data from existing sources. We compared multiple data sets whenever we could. That wasn't terribly easy. We did randomly select states and indicators to call to make sure we weren't misinterpreting data. If there were missing data, we did call and get those filled in. So out of 459 data points, we only had 2 pieces of missing data. This is a very wonky term I'm going to use, so roll with me here. That's technically a missing data rate of awesomeness. I'm serious, it really is. That's awesome. Much better than we actually thought. Shockingly enough, no state is hitting it out of the park in terms of inputs or outcomes. I think the best grade we could give a state was a B-, and that was on the input side, and it was literally a handful of states. So of the 9 policies that we were looking for, most were picked because they were low or no cost intervention types of policies. No state had more than, I think the most was 6. Out of those 9. Some states do a lot more than others, but they're all basically in the middle. And the lack of data on participation was really troubling to us. And this becomes a really big issue because we had some states where they had a mandate to serve, and they actually had money for each identified high-performing student, but there was no monitoring on how that money was used. So in some states, we found anecdotal evidence that they were using the money for other things. So the participation rate was literally 0%. A district can get $1 million to work on advanced education, and 0% of students benefit from that. Participation is really important. Several states do well with aggregated outcomes. Every state has an excellence gap problem, every single state. Skip that. Very quickly, to give you a taste here, does the state education agency audit it, monitor, report? Some do and some don't. Does the state permit acceleration? State policies, we generally did not give a state full credit if they let the local district decide, because you can figure out which districts are likely to have these policies if they have the option and which aren't. We see that as a primary excellence gap driver. This was fascinating to me. I have spoken in the last 9 days in 2 of the 4 green states, and in both states, the people there said, that's the policy, I went through those programs, we never talked about these kids once. So again, participation data versus policy data. And the outputs we've already kind of talked about. If your excellence gap was even kind of smallish compared to everybody else's, we gave states full credit because everyone's gaps are so big. So some very quick observations. Different indicators may give different results, probably not. Missing indicators, probably not. We were really easy graders. The first time that we did it, the grades were kind of depressing. For example, we had monitor and audit separate, and we thought if we combine it, there's better scores for people. We didn't want this to be punitive with everyone getting Fs. So everyone got Cs and Ds, which probably wasn't much better. But this is really is about state policy. We're focusing on state policy, not are the teachers doing a good job, is it the students' fault? Totally different debates. This was really about state policy only. And again, we really think that most policymakers, especially in the aftermath, they don't understand the nature of the problem. And that's what we've really been trying to focus on. Right now, we're going around the country, meeting with state policymakers, going through their data, and talking about how we can get some of these policies in place. And with that, I will turn it over to Erik.
Thank you very much, doctor. I think I'm the only one that's not a doctor up here, so I'm also the only one that doesn't have slides. But thank you very much for coming out here. My name is Erik Fresen. I'm a state representative in the state of Florida. And you know, part of the reason why I don't have slides is A, I didn't want to deal with the awkwardness of having to get upset from the slides not working. But really, at the same time, really more importantly, because a lot of what I'm going to say right now, while it absolutely is specific to the topic that we're discussing here today, which is what's going on with a certain group of people that aren't allowing themselves, you know, the system is not allowing to achieve at a certain level, and others that aren't, there are so much of what I'm about to say right now and what I can say in the Q&A that's translatable or transferable to just about any discussion that's going on in this summit over the next 2 days. And we heard a lot about it in the morning. You're gonna hear a lot about it probably at some point tonight. But getting to the point of diagnosing what the problem is, and really what I wanna talk about, is that the crux of the problem of this specific conversation and conversations that you're gonna hear in other rooms, whether it's about the lowest performers, whether it's about minorities, whether it's about closing the poverty index, closing the minority index, closing the language index, whatever those indexes are, there is one persistent problem with the manner in which we are delivering education in this state, in this country, all across the country, which we should all get an F on. And it's because of the fact that while we have at certain points changed where we're gonna swing the pendulum, are we focusing on the high performers, are we focusing on the middle performers, are we focusing on the low performers, that entire pendulum is always swinging on the same fulcrum. And that fulcrum is, we are looking at education as a system-wide, group-based delivery system, which is to say we look at education delivery as what's Florida doing, not what is education being delivered to the individual child. So the unless you move away from that for 1 second, whether it's in this discussion, whether it's in any discussion, as long as we continue to do the same thing in education delivery, which is to say we're talking about system funding, we're talking about systems, states, districts, whatever it may be, you are never going to tackle the problem of achievement gaps between certain groups because of the fact that all individuals are not created the same way. People learn in different ways. People's experiences are different. People's cultures are different. The manner in which people obtain, react to, and actually achieve in learning are always as individuals, not as groups of people, not as Floridians, not as Georgians, not as minorities, not as blacks, not as Hispanics. They learn as individuals. But the problem is that we always try to look and swing that pendulum to say, well, what are we doing as an education system? And therein lies the problem. See, the whole this issue of whether or not we're not allowing gifted students to succeed to their level, or whether or not we're leaving, you know, the no child left behind, if we continue to focus all of our education policies on platitudinal bumper stickers to say, well, no child left behind, that's our focus now, or let's focus on the gifted, we're missing the point. And the point is that unless we're really ready on a public policy level to have the courage to completely reform the education system, to completely change the fulcrum upon which that pendulum swings, which is to say, we are not going to look at education anymore as a system-wide thing, as a district-based thing, as a group-based thing, but we're going to look at it as an individualized student, as an individual consumer based thing, we're never going to tackle that problem. There's always going to exist gaps between states, between people, between cultures, between income levels. Gaps were always going to exist. If we keep on trying to tackle the education problem and say, well, we're going to tackle it as a system, it's an impossible thing to do. So what do we need to do? We have to understand that different children grow at different places, but we have to also stop this mentality of trying to find a policy that can sell itself at a national level, a policy that's going to sell itself at a state level or at a district level, such as, well, what are we going to do with, you know, the gifted population? Well, let's go in and let's say that we're going to go ahead and do, you know, certain levels of, you know, group instruction. But then what's the problem? That's always confronted with policies or requests for policies of general application. In the state of Florida, I'll give you a prime example. State of Florida, something that sounds fantastic, this concept called the class size amendment. We have it in Florida. It sounds great. No more than 18, no more than 22, no more than 25 students in a classroom. It sounds fantastic, absolutely. But it's a policy that is broadly applied and has no basis in logic. Why? Because that kind of individualized instruction that was mentioned in Findlay Elementary, which is to say, well, we need to have some flexibility to recognize that certain students may be able to excel in a certain environment, and maybe that principal can identify 19, 20 gifted students and say, I'm going to put these 20 gifted students at this level to accelerate at this level, but perhaps these 14 or 15 who are perhaps struggling need to be in an even smaller classroom. Guess what? A well-sounding policy of general application like 18, 22, 25 precludes you from being able to do that, because you now have to take the students that are in 14 and put them in 18, and the students that could perhaps succeed at 20, they're going to be put at 18 also. And all of these policies, whatever the focus seems to be, wherever the pendulum swings, whether it's to the high performers, whether it's to the middle performers, or whether it's to the low performers, it's always going to end up focusing on group dynamic as opposed to delivering education in a manner in which technology can today, in a manner in which human capital can today, in a manner in which every other consumable good in this country is received other than education, because nobody tries to do this group mentality. So this entire concept of onward and up, you know, this concept of trying to figure out how we can harness a child's full ability, whether it's at the gifted spectrum or whether it's accelerating them if they're a low performer, or if they started off on the wrong track, or if they did not have the same access to early childhood education, quality early childhood education. If we continue to have all of our policies try to fit within a neat four-cornered box of a policy that can be easily said in a 30-second commercial, or that requires some sort of courage to battle against the standards of the status quo, which is to say, well, we want to talk about districts and everything is set up constitutionally from something that was thought about 150 years ago, that this is the way that we're going to deliver education, and it has not adapted whatsoever because of the fact that the system is so deeply predicated on the status quo and then just keeping classrooms looking the way they are because it's comfortable for the adults. So what I would say is this: before we get too deep into the data, we understand the gaps are going to be there. We know the gaps are there. The gaps are absolutely there. We're not allowing high-achieving students to soar, and we're also, at the same time, because we're keeping them down, we're trying to put everything into the middle of the bell curve to just feel good about ourselves and say we did something for everybody. And the problem is that unless we flip that paradigm and start saying we're going to allow equal access of high quality to the individual, to where they need to be, to what they can succeed succeed at to the pace that they need to be at, we're never going to tackle the problem. There's always going to be a gap, even within the gaps. So what I would suggest, and what I hope the conversation on this panel turns into, is not just recognizing the data, recognizing the gaps, but really challenging everybody in this room, everybody in this summit, to have the courage to say the manner in which we are delivering education in this country, period. We can compare states, but all states are the same when it comes to how they apply their policies, and more importantly, how they fund and how they deliver education as blocks, as opposed to individualized to the student. If we can start tackling that, if we can start figuring out with the monies that the states are spending, how can we best deliver that so that the student that's achieving at a high level can allow their path to continue without necessarily having to slow down for somebody else, while at the same time not expecting greatness from the entire system, while recognizing that we also have certain students that don't start at the same point that some of the other students started out at, and not penalizing those, but allowing the same level of individualized education delivery to the students at every level of the academic spectrum. That's the challenge. To whatever extent the conversation is going to center on that, center on the fact that we need to move away from the status quo and really tackle the fact that all gaps are going to continue to exist if we keep on looking at education as a group mentality and as district-based and as state-based, that's where I think the problem is going to be, and I hope the conversation opens up to that. So thank you.
And I thought I was radical.
That's interesting.
Agree with Erik about individualizing, and I'll come back to that in a minute. But I do think policy matters, and I do think it makes a difference, especially at the state level. And I do urge you to dig into that Jack Kent Cook report, because you'll find a report card on your own state on that website. You won't like it, but you, I think, need to know what it says. And while you're online on Monday, you can also get the newest NAEP data on your state. 2015 achievement data will be out on Monday, and you can see lots of things. But among the things you can see is whether anybody else has gotten to the advanced level, at least in reading and math, because those are the results that are going to be out on Monday from the 2015 NAEP administration. I'm here in part to flog a new book, which John Schnur was nice enough to refer to in an earlier panel. It's called Failing Our Brightest Kids, The Global Challenge of Educating High-Ability Students. There are some flyers about it on the table with the water near the door. I encourage you to have a look if you like. I'm going to show you just a little bit of what we found in the book, my co-author and I, if I can make this machine work. I actually haven't the faintest idea what to do, but let's see. Except that's not where I started, is it? Let's see. You've already been told and shown earlier that the United States does a poor job of producing high-scoring achievement, high-scoring students. These are PISA data, and we're comparing ourselves with other OECD countries. On the most recent PISA administration, which is 2012, looking for kids who make it into the highest ranks, which are levels 5 and 6 on PISA, we're beaten by 27 of 34 countries in math, by 20 countries in science, and by 18 countries in reading. This, on the vertical axis, are the average PISA math scores of these countries. There's 11 of them here, 12 counting the US, because that's what we looked at in the book. This is fundamentally an international study. So the average PISA score is on the vertical axis. On the horizontal score, the percentage of kids in that country who reached the high scoring level on PISA in math in 2012. The United States is down there in the lower left corner with Hungary. We have neither a high average score nor a significant percentage of high scoring students compared to these other countries that I think are reasonable countries to compare ourselves with. I mean, Germany, Canada, Korea, England, Australia. I think these are reasonable comparisons, and it doesn't look pretty. If you look at, and this is what Christina was getting at earlier, if you look at low SES kids who make it into the high-scoring ranks on PISA, okay, On the horizontal axis are how many kids from the bottom quartile, SES, get into the high scoring ranks. And you'll notice that the scale is very spread out because nobody gets more than 25% of their bottom quartile kids into the high scoring ranks. But the United States is down around 3%. On the vertical axis is the percent of kids from the top quartile in that country who make it into the high scoring ranks. We don't do very well there either, 20%. Of top quartile kids in the high-scoring ranks, we are in fact the worst on this lot, and we are surpassed by everybody else in this study in terms of the percentage of top quartile kids who get into the high-scoring ranks. And this does the same thing with parental education. The horizontal axis are the percent of high scorers who had neither parent graduate even from high school. The vertical axis is the percent of kids who become high scorers where at least one parent graduated from college. Needless to say, kids with college graduate parents do better everywhere. But if you look at the international rankings, the United States not only does very badly with kids from poorly educated parents, it doesn't do very well with kids from well-educated parents either. All these other countries do better. So how do they do it? Well, I went, and we studied 11 other countries, and that's what this book is mostly about. And they do a lot of things differently, and none of them has it licked. In no place, for example, the percent of poor kids among high scorers equal to the percent of rich kids among high scorers. Nobody's got it licked. But where our ratio is like 1 to 8, other countries have it down to 1 to 3. So what do they do? Well, not everything we can picture doing in the United States, but it's worth at least thinking about. Japan, almost all the high schools have selective admission based on exams. Singapore, they screen all kids in third grade to see who's going to get into their special gifted education schools starting in fourth grade, full-time gifted classrooms. Western Australia screens everybody in fourth grade and runs gifted sections of some high schools and has two high schools that are only for gifted kids. Germany, some of the high schools have special sections for high achievers within them. Ontario treats gifted kids as part of special ed, which is a mixed blessing, I think. But it does bring some benefits, some resources, some extra attention, and of course a lot of bureaucracy. Once you categorize gifted kids as part of special ed. Those are examples. There are lots more examples in the book. But let me flip to among the 10 recommendations that Brandon and I suggest that the United States consider. Beyond the purpose of this session and others like it, which is to get it on the agenda at all and pay attention to this topic, what could we do? Well, we could do universal screening. We're already testing every single third grader in math and reading because we have to under federal law. And that's the one thing that's not likely to go away under the reauthorization of the federal law. So who are the high scorers in third grade? That's not going to be all the kids you want to pay attention to. You also want to ask teachers to nominate other kids. But what if you looked at the 5 or 10% of highest scorers in third grade? And then what if you asked the teachers to nominate some more kids? So starting in fourth grade, what could we do differently? Well, we might allow acceleration. The only gifted education program in the United States with a truly robust research track record is acceleration, letting them move faster. To become a lot more radical and to echo Erik, what if we let everybody move at their own speed? What if we let everybody move at their own speed? Why does every 11-year-old have to be in something called fifth grade and held to the same standards and tested on the same test? Well, because we structure our schools that way. Is that good for kids? I don't think so. I don't think it's good for high-ability kids who could be somewhere else. And I'm not sure it's good for low achievers who in many cases are being discouraged by not succeeding in fifth grade when in fact they're plugging along at the third grade level. But to alter our system to allow people to move at their own speed would require a radical overhaul, as Erik implied, of just about everything we have by way of structures, including, incidentally, grade-level academic standards. Because if all fifth graders are held to the same academic standards, whether they're your state's own standards or Common Core or anything else, and if they're then tested on an exam that only looks at what's in the fifth grade standards, and especially if the test is limited, as it currently is by federal law, to only material that is grade level. Therefore, a fifth grader who is in fact doing math at the eighth grade level, you won't even be able to see her growth on the fifth grade assessment, because the test isn't allowed under federal law to show that kind of growth. So one of the other changes we have to make is we've got to give schools and districts and states credit for moving all their kids forward, a growth model, if you want to use the policy term, in any kind of an accountability regime that a state comes up with. But to do that for kids at all levels on the spectrum, you've got to have different kinds of tests. You've got to be more flexible about standards. So there's a lot of changes that are implied. Who's getting gypped by the current system? It is not smart kids from upper middle class families. My granddaughters, all of whom of course are smart, are going to be fine because they've got caring, reasonably prosperous grown-ups navigating them through the American education system with some savvy about how it works and with the capacity to make changes when necessary and to supplement their education when necessary. They're going to do okay. They could do better, but they're going to do okay. Equally smart kids from disadvantaged circumstances are getting really screwed by the way we currently organize our system, because they're the ones that depend on the formal education system and don't have caring, prosperous adults who know their way around, who are navigating through the system. So this is an equity issue. It is a national, international competitiveness issue. And I may suggest it is a social mobility issue, because who are the poor kids likeliest to rise on the American ladder of achievement if they're given the chance? They're the smart poor kids, and right now we're not giving them the chance. Thank you very much. Back to you, Hanna.
Great, thank you. I thought I'd take a minute, since I get to represent the state of New Mexico, and talk about, I said earlier, this is such a timely conversation. And I want to talk about some of the things that I think make it so timely, and I'll represent New Mexico, but I think I represent a lot of states across this nation right now. First of all, we had Dr. Theakis and then and actually Checker also mentioned the concept of growth. Let's be clear, we may continue, and I believe we will continue to evolve when it comes to better and better assessments. But right now, for the first time ever, I think we have the majority of states capturing growth. We're not just asking a binary question of, are we proficient or aren't we proficient? We're asking, how much are we improving, which allows us to measure progress across the spectrum. For the first time in our state, when we implemented a school grading policy that measures the majority, measures growth, it does measure proficiency as well, but measures growth, our highest performing schools, for the first time, had asked some serious questions that they weren't too happy when they first had to ask them about their high-performing kids and whether or not they were actually really serving them and serving them well. So we have the opportunity to actually begin to ask the tough questions and do something about it based on the data versus having a binary conversation about, are we basically where we think we should be or shouldn't be? I would say that also across the spectrum as we look at a new, very popular concept of teacher evaluations. Based on student achievement and growth. While not particularly popular as they've been rolled out, what we have failed to do, that I believe we will do, is ask some really tough questions about, no matter what school you go to, no matter which teacher you have, are we realizing growth across the spectrum for every single student? And the time has come, we have the tools to do that, and that is unique to just 10 years ago when we did not have that taking place. Those conversations are pivotal to beginning to attack, I believe, the fulcrum of this conversation. I would also make a couple other, I will validate absolutely what you said, Checker, about our most disadvantaged students. I will share this story, and I think it captures the dynamic that we deal with on a regular basis at the local level, and that is I have a little sister in the Big Brother Big Sister program. She's been my little sister for 3 years. I had the privilege of going to her parent-teacher conference this last year. It was her teacher's best day. That was a joke. When the Secretary of Education comes and sits down, it's probably not that teacher's best day, but I got to go. And just to be clear, my little sister, English is not her first language, nor is it her mom's, who I had the privilege of attending with. But we were proud that day as we sat down because we heard over and over again how high-achieving my little sister is. 95s and 100s on every single measure, every single grade, and in the sense of subject, excuse me. And so we're all feeling pretty good. And at the end, I had been silent. If you know me, that's pretty shocking. And I said, I have two questions. And the first question I asked is she on grade level? Is she, you know, where she should be? She's so high achieving. I'm so excited. And the answer was no, not in reading, not in math. And I share that. Is grade level the ultimate challenge? Is that what we really want? No. But it is a starting point to ask, where are we at? And her mom, for the first time ever, was able to advocate on her behalf. And there's an ensuing story from there. But I share that to say my little sister is high performing. She was the third in her entire school. She's not the top grade on her spelling bee. So she's a smart little girl. But depending on where you are, when it comes to equal access and equal opportunity, and what classroom you might be in, you might not have those opportunities. And yes, those are the students that are getting gypped. And there are 599 other students in her school that don't have a Secretary for Education as a big sister. So is this conversation relevant for our nation, for our states, for our schools, for our classrooms? Absolutely. Too many students, high-performing students, do not have advocates that are giving this opportunity. A couple other points I want to make on why I believe this is so timely. Yes, we can measure growth. I think that is crucial in this conversation. Secondly, there's also, I mentioned earlier, over 40 states have raised their standards and adopted assessments to align to those standards. And Checker, you're right. We're always going to be looking for a better, more sophisticated assessment. But have we taken a huge step in being able to measure? I believe we have when it comes to measuring and closing our honesty gaps. Let me give an example. Now, have we gotten it all the way where we need to go? No. But let's think about at the high school level, for example, for the first time in New Mexico, we gave subject-specific, not grade-specific, assessments in math. We're giving a park assessment. And so for the first time, we're measuring Algebra 2, not a general assessment that asks some general questions about how our students are doing in high school. That's significant because a ninth grader can take the Algebra 2 assessment or an 11th grader. So as we think about individualized assessment and beginning to be more subject and achievement appropriate, not grade appropriate, I think we are taking steps in that direction. I think of our eighth graders in New Mexico who just took the Algebra 1 assessment. Not all our eighth graders did, but 20% of them did. And for the first time, we're measuring our high-achieving eighth graders and asking really great questions. By the way, our eighth graders, our high-performing eighth graders, outperformed all of our ninth and our 10th graders on the Algebra 1 assessment. For the first time, we're able to challenge those eighth graders in a way that's significant. So we always have a long way to go, but I want to put in context, we would not be having this conversation just 2 years ago. We would not have been having this conversation around growth, actually. We wouldn't be having the conversation around stepping towards the right kinds of assessments that give us real feedback and the opportunity to challenge our students. So we're at a pivotal time in history, in my opinion, to tackle what I consider a moral mandate around every student in our nation. And I think we've heard from our panelists about many of the ways we can do that. And so what I would say to us as we open this up and ask some questions, as we leave here today, we have to think about what's our role, not just to listen and agree and get depressed by data. Yes, I said that out loud. But to say, what are we going to do about it? And I think we've had some great things put on the table. So I want to start by asking a few key questions, and then we'll open it up for the audience. Dr. Theakis, I mentioned New Mexico, and we using growth in our school accountability, our teacher evaluation systems. What are you seeing? We've had a lot of states go for No Child Left Behind or ESEA waivers. And how do you believe waivers play and states in their applications, et cetera, and ensuing policies, how has that played a role in this conversation, and how should we look ahead for that to play a role?
Yeah, no, can folks hear me with this? I guess I have to get a little closer. I think the waivers have presented an opportunity that many states are taking advantage of, which is a really great step in the first direction. In terms of starting to signal. I think I told the school example to show that our current policies aren't hindering good schools from doing the right things for students, but we can change the policy environment so it's actually signaling and supporting more schools to be doing what some schools are currently doing for all kids and how they're doing it for the kids who are traditionally underserved in the system of high achieving, getting kids to high achieving and to advanced levels. So when we look sort of across the waivers, we look across what some states are doing. I think some of the things that we're seeing are in using the accountability systems as they exist and changing, where we're not talking about getting kids over a bar, an arbitrary bar that we decided was proficient, some well-positioned, some not well-positioned, and saying how are schools doing? Let's start evaluating schools and how they're doing on growth to what you're talking about in New Mexico. And also giving schools points for getting kids to advance. So they're signaling that advanced is a goal. So if we have sort of better assessments, we have better sort of tracking of those levels. There are some states who are putting getting kids to advance in their system. Some states are giving schools bonus points for having more kids in the advance versus more kids in the low area. I think as well, in terms of public reporting, we're seeing states signaling rigorous opportunities being important to kids and disaggregating that data, showing that data and disaggregating that data, for example, with AP or IB or Cambridge tests, and putting those out there and saying these are important. We want to see access for all kids, and we want to track access and success in those classes for kids. So I think we're starting to use the accountability system to do that. And I think it's also important to say that rigorous standards are also part of this as well. There was a reason that we decided we needed more rigorous standards. There was a reason we decided that we needed to define what kids needed to know and be able to do in different grade levels. And that's because so many kids are underserved in the system, and we need to make sure that there is a bar and that we're stretching for a higher bar. So I think that's the foundation, and I think that foundation has been in place, and that's why we're seeing this activity happening. We learned a lot. The data was important. It's important that we have the data so we can see how kids are doing, where kids aren't achieving, so we can continue to move forward and correct on those things.
Great. Checker.
Ma'am.
I've got to pick on you for a minute. We could say this to the entire panel. We could say this is kind of an elitist conversation. You know, we've got all these PhDs up here and a representative who's been representing since 2008, pretty accomplished people. How do we justify a conversation like this when we still have so many students that are truly being left behind on the lower performing spectrum?
Well, this has got to be a country that can walk and chew gum at the same time. We've only been walking. We've been working on kids at the lower end of the spectrum and making some gains, as Christine's data showed. But we ought to be able to simultaneously be paying attention to the ceiling in the room as well as the floor. One of the reasons this gets called elitist is because the kids who end up in our current gifted programs do tend to be white and Asian, and that's because it's a circular problem. The kids who end up in these programs are white and Asian because they've got the system and the adults who are getting them into these programs. The equally able kids from poor and minority backgrounds aren't getting into them because the system isn't helping them get into them. And so it becomes a kind of self-fulfilling prophecy. I think this is the opposite of elitism. I think this is actually, as I said a minute ago, a crucial equity point that we have sorely neglected and need to steel ourselves to address.
Representative Fresen, I think we all were moved by your statements about individual students and the importance and how we've lost sight often of focusing on our individual children versus systems, et cetera. Mm-hmm. But I'm gonna push on you a little bit. I think Checker did as well, but I'll push a little harder and ask you, and we've got a lot of policymakers in the room, isn't there a place though, And is there a way, when it comes to policy and systems, to incentivize the status quo, as you mentioned, or to incentivize truly reaching individual students and encouraging this conversation to move to action?
Yeah, absolutely. And I realized afterwards when I guess it was either misunderstood or misstated by me, the concept that policy doesn't matter. On the contrary, policy is what matters. The problem is, if we keep on trying to tailor fit our policy into the four corners of a system that doesn't work, there's not a single policy in the world that you can pepper at this problem that's ever gonna work. So what I meant by it is that the policies that are needed in order to manifest the actual outcomes that everybody here is wanting, which is to allow high achievers to continue to soar, to allow individualized instructions to the low one, you know, to the lower achievers, so that they can actually grow at their pace. The only thing that's going to change that is the most courageous policies of all, which is to take the entire system as it exists right now and disrupt it completely. That's going to require policy changes, but it's not going to require taking data that we know of achievement gaps and pumping it into an existing system and trying to fit it within and massage it within policies that don't work. It does require policy, it requires courageous policy. You need to flip the entire system. You need to stop funding institutions, stop funding systems, stop funding districts, and really just fund and create your policies around individual choice. The reason why his grandchildren have access, it's not just because because they have prosperous, you know, well-educated parents. It's because those parents know about the choices they have, and they have actual choices to make for their students. Those that are the lower socioeconomic status, the system does not inform them of their choices, nor create choices for them to actually have individualized instruction. So it is incumbent upon us to create the very policies that will change the policies as they are, and create new policies that will actually go towards individualized instruction, so that those on the lower rungs can actually climb at their pace and have the expectation and high standards to make sure that they achieve it, but never to forget the fact that a student that's moving quickly is going to be held down by a system-centric mentality.
Great. Dr. Plucker, I'm going to put you on the spot. So 9 indicators you looked at throughout the nation in regards to how well or lack thereof we're encouraging our students at the higher end. Let me ask you this. One policy, you could choose one policy that began to, Not the end, the beginning, in every state, maybe tailored to Representative Friesen's point, but the game changer policy that you believe would incentivize not the status quo, but the individual student and the growth of all students, and in no way neglecting our high performers.
That's kind of easy, actually. Every strategy that everyone has mentioned up here, some schools have been using for over 20 to 25 years. Tons of research support, especially acceleration. You probably didn't hear Erik talk about vouchers for all. We actually suspect that will not work for a reason. If I have time, I will come back to that, because it seems like it would be perfect, but it doesn't actually play out that way. Acceleration, and that involves this. I mean, is there a legislature on the planet? Well, let's stick to our country, because we're special. Is there an American legislature in any state that doesn't argue about what the kindergarten cutoff date should be every single session? Mm-hmm. I'm gonna introduce a bill, I'm moving it 2 weeks back. Huh? What about when the kid's ready? In how many middle schools can children in this country take high school courses and get credit for it? There are states that have policies strictly prohibiting that. There's no excuse for that. A student should be able to graduate from high school early and move on to college when they're ready for it and when they choose to do it. It's not going to be for everybody. Sports is a complicating factor. The prom's a complicating factor. I get it. But there are ways around those problems, right? But this is why the voucher program is tricky. So we used to say, wouldn't it be great if every state had a money follows the child funding system? Seems like it would fit with this tailoring and individualization so well. Except for one thing, if you have a student and they're ready to move on to college a year early, there's an incentive for the school to discourage them from doing so, because the money moves on. Every state that's put incentive programs in place to help mediate that, over time, it's a 6 to 7 year window, it's a study that we're finishing now, the discouragement takes over and the numbers drop to almost nothing. And so acceleration, defined broadly, there's 14 different acceleration strategies. How's that for a wonky answer? All are associated with decades of research saying they work for any child who has the opportunity, especially if we start really, really early. So if I had to pick one, that's one that we know works for everybody, period.
Great. I would just say what I've heard, some folks would call that competency-based learning, giving that opportunity. I mean, there's some nuances, and I get that. But the when a child knows their material, let them roll. When they don't, you know, hold and let's make sure we master our material, which there's, across this nation, that is a big push. We want mastery, not just check a box on a grade. And so I think we can agree that that's an important piece. I want to open it up to audience questions. I'll just close on this end and open it with this. I'm sure you're all waiting with bated breath to know what happened to my little sister. Wanted to give you a word of encouragement before we transition. You should know her mom went to the principal that same day and said, can I get a tutor? The answer, and this is not a slam, I know this principal well, but the answer was she's too high performing for this school.
Very common.
And since that time, her mom had the opportunity, and it was a lot about communication. And the first thing her mom said to me is, can you put her in a private school for me? I said, no. I happen to be over at public schools. We're going to work on that one. And I said, what about another public school? And my little sister got on a waiting list for a high-performing charter school. Her little sisters got on a waiting list for a high-performing charter school. And they're both, all three of them are now in that school. So choice was alluded to here, competency-based learning, growth and measuring, so we're holding ourselves accountable. But more than anything in this conversation, what are we doing each and every day as we think, whether we're a policymaker, a parent, get to lead a district, a state, to not just start this conversation, but take an action on it. So I'll open it up for each one of you to ask questions.
Can I make one comment while we're waiting for someone to, can I break protocol for
you
a second?
You can break protocol.
I think your example is a very good example, but I would hate for people to walk away and think that that doesn't happen to white upper income kids too.
Agreed.
Part of this problem is an attitude problem. It's just good old fashioned American anti-intellectualism. And we can't, I
agree.
That's happened to my kids. I've had that conversation with teachers where they've said, your son's above grade level. And we go, awesome. And she goes, well, no, he's above grade level. Isn't that great? I'm like, it's October. No, it's not great. We have to do something for him. It never occurred to her.
Agreed.
And so I think this is a bit more pervasive than even I just made it sound, right? Is that a part of this is a general attitude problem that we have to tackle.
100% agree, and I think Checker made a bit of that point. I would just say this, and I say this on my behalf and your behalf, we knew the question to ask or the push. And so we've got two issues, right? You've got to have equipped parents, and you've got to have asking the right questions. All right, let's get roll.
Thanks, Sarah. Everything was great. My name is Matt Minnick from Teach America Florida. Representative Fresen, I just wanted to give you little thanks for reminding us all that the individual is important. As a former teacher and as the son of a 40-year-plus educator, I always remember my mother saying that there's no such thing as a problem child. There are children with unique problems that the educator has to help overcome. So thank you for your words. My question is, all these things sound great, but we still have to have teachers who are able to maximize the potential of every individual student, both the lowest income, the minorities, the lowest performing, the highest performing. So I'd be curious to hear thoughts just on ideas for how teacher preparation, teacher development, how that's going to have to change as this education system or the way in which we approach each individual student changes. So thank you.
Who wants to take that one?
Yes, I'll take it. I think twofold. Firstly, I think there's two parts to that question. The first one is, how do we ensure over the next 10 or 15 years that we're going to have the highest quality, most competent teachers in the classroom? And I think that you do have to center policies around making sure that that the workforce that you're training to be in front of those kids is going to be competent, that the expectation of what the training that's involved in teaching is going to be of a high quality, and more importantly, that you're incentivizing, which we're trying to do in Florida now, you're trying to move the needle and incentivize more of the kids that either through misperception or proper perception coming out of high school and going into universities and colleges are not choosing education or a career in education as their, matter of fact, one of the common denominators in every one of the countries that was mentioned in that longitudinal study and comparative study of the US has a much higher percentage of their education workforce that actually is of their higher performing out of high school students. So that's one of the topics to tackle. But I think the second one is also then the system and the expectation that the system has of those teachers. If a teacher comes in, regardless of preparation, regardless of competence, regardless of drive and ambition to teach, and the system basically tells him or her, we're functioning within these four corners, and we're going to tell you that you're going to get these 30 students, and here's what we want. At the end of the day, we want a group outcome that is defensible for us as a system so that we can say this school did X. So what happens is over time, other than the teacher's intrinsic humanistic quality of wanting to teach the individual child, the system is not set up for that teacher to actually target that individual child. Classrooms aren't set up that way. Education delivery is not set up that way. So you're almost condemning teachers into a system that does not allow them to do that very thing which they want to do, which is to reach that individual child and allow that child, his son, for example, to actually accelerate. Because that teacher just found all of a sudden a great calm in the fact that his child was way above grade level. So now for a second, she's going to take her focus and put it on someone else. His child gets left behind. Somebody else is getting focused on, and there's no individualized instruction. In order to really set teachers of the, once we prepare them competently and once you have competent teachers there, you have to give them a system that actually allows them to excel and to achieve and to allow kids to achieve at the highest level. And in order to do that, you have to give them an environment that allows for individualized instruction.
I mean, I also want to comment briefly on that because I'm teaching in those teacher and administrator prep programs. And I have to be careful what I say or my colleagues stop taking me to lunch, so I'm going to soft pedal this a little bit. But we need to... we need to blow up the whole system, which that was probably not as soft-pedaled as it was in my brain before I said it. Oh, we're not taping it, right? People have been trying to change teacher and administrator prep for a long time. I think 15 years ago, we couldn't change the way we taught reading. Universities wanted to do it very differently than we needed them to do it in schools, so we changed the accountability systems. I think we need to do the same thing for this too, and I think almost everyone has said it. The accountability systems have to change. If that happens, at the same time, I think Eric's point is a great one if we're putting so we teach teachers how to differentiate, et cetera, then we put them into schools where there's no ability grouping whatsoever, no flexible ability grouping. Mm-hmm. If I wanted to design a school that made differentiation as difficult as humanly possible, that's exactly what I would do. And that's what many public schools do in this country. The research is clear on this point. That's going to make differentiation much harder, and we're not teaching teachers to differentiate well. The combination of those two literally makes it almost impossible.
Next question.
Thank you. My name is David Harvin, Sr., and I run a small Christian school in South Florida. And part of my question was your question as well, that the ideas that you're talking about, Representative Erik, are phenomenal. It is much harder done than said. Being a former teacher also, teaching dropout prevention, 7th and 8th grade, I could tell you differentiated learning is not an easy thing to do. But I would like to make a comment because we were talking about standards, and I'm not sure where the standards actually come from. I've been told that they come from the state, but I find out that the goal that we have as educators is to make sure that our children go to a a college when they graduate, UF or Harvard or Stanford. And Stanford sets you FSU. but they set the standard. And when they set that standard, it triggers down to the high schools and triggers down to the middle schools and eventually the elementary schools. And now I'm seeing that Singapore and Finland is the standard.
I'm going to push you for a question.
Yeah. So I'm sorry. I'm just, it's really a comment. And I would say a question
a
also.
One.
Basically, where are the standards coming from, and how are we able to reach standards that, in my opinion, have not been clearly identified?
Great. Anyone want to?
Well, it's a different panel, frankly. The standards issue, which has been lively in the United States, especially these last few years, and which apply to public schools, probably not to your Christian school in Florida, have typically been set by states based on whatever process the state uses, and they are pretty weird, those processes. And more recently, a lot of states have fallen into the Common Core standards, which were set by a group of basically education experts. It's the best way to say it. I happen to think the Common Core standards are pretty good, but if they haven't been clearly communicated to you, that is perhaps because somebody in Tallahassee hasn't explained them thoroughly to the schools of Florida.
All right, moving on. We have time for two more quick questions.
I think this will be quick. I'm Representative Carolyn Brown from Arkansas, and I saw the depressing statistics about where the United States ranks with other countries. Some educators have pointed out to me in the last year or so that a lot of times those statistics that show that America is so poor performing in comparison to other countries, it's really kind of an apples and oranges comparison, because a lot of these other countries have very exclusionary practices, whereas they don't test all of their students or they don't bother to educate all of their students. So they're not as democratically set up as we are here in the United States, so it's kind of hard to do a real comparison. Is that an accurate description, or should we feel just horribly depressed? Because I still feel like America does lots more dynamic things than I ever hear from any of these other countries.
Yeah. So I'll take a little bit of that first. So to calm a little bit of the depression, I do think one of the several of the unique characteristics of the United States, and I think it's something that has to be our badge of honor, is the fact that we do attempt to educate. We really say it's open for all, everybody. We want to make sure that we provide everybody with some access to education, and perhaps it's arguable that some of those countries don't. You can also argue that some of those countries, especially on the higher end, have much more homogenous populations, and in the United States we don't. But then again, let's go back to the depressing part. To that point, especially because of the fact that we don't have a homogenous population, especially because of the fact that we have a high immigrant population, especially because of the fact that we're not segregating and excluding certain students after a certain, age group or whatever, or tracking them into something else, even more reason why we have to predicate our education system on the individual characteristics of a student as opposed to system-based things. A system-based application in a country like Singapore or Japan that has an almost exclusively homogenous population may be actually easier to accomplish than it is in the United States. That's what we need to learn from. Now, the fact of the matter is, to the question before, where do our standards come from? Regardless of what your state standards are, or whether it's Common Core, or whether it's Florida standards, or whatever it is, when you take our supposed highest performers and rank them on an internationally benchmarked assessment to the highest performers in other countries, they're kicking our butts. So there is something to be said about that, and we can't blind ourselves to that reality by calling ourselves a melting pot and saying that they have homogenous populations. So I don't want to get tempered into that. But I would also make this point, that the one distinct characteristic when we go into K-12 and say that all these countries are kicking our butts is, while our K-12 system may be lacking comparatively to all these countries, there's one thing that is consistent and still to this day. All of the students in those countries, or every other country, wants to come to our higher ed system. And here's the one distinct characteristic that nobody can ever argue against. The only difference in our country between our higher ed system and our K-12 system is that nobody tells you where to go to college. Right? So individuals, based on their aptitude and their unique characteristics, can pick their college or get accepted into a college or not go, and there is a marketplace of higher ed opportunities for everybody, and our higher ed system is the international standard. So we need to learn that and actually try to apply some of the things we know in our higher ed system and apply them in K-12.
All right, we're basically out of time. Does anyone want to add to that? Because I think that's
a really important
question.
Yes, very, 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 very quickly. 20 years ago, that was a fair statement. I used to believe it myself. And talking to the people who run those international tests, it is not an apples to orange comparison anymore. China's PISA data, I wouldn't hang a lot of faith on that. All the other test results, they really have worked through most of these sampling issues. It's not as biased as it used to be.
One last question. We've got about 30 seconds.
Okay. My name is Melissa. I'm from Vail, Colorado. I've been a principal for 8 years in a high minority school, 98% Hispanic, 89% Spanish speaking. And we were able to raise achievement. We got from turnaround to National Blue Ribbon School, but I was never in 8 years able to qualify any minority students for the Gifted and Talented program. And so my question is, with the universal screening, we did Naglieri, we did COGAT, other countries, what are they doing in order to successfully screen, or are there other districts or states that have been able to do successful universal screening, especially for language minority students?
Yeah, I think it's a great question, and I think the universal screening typically picks up far more kids than we would get otherwise. And I think one of the things that some progressive districts do is they have, instead of using the national norms, they use school-based norms, so there are kids who are identified in every school, so it's both equity and excellence that we're going for. And there are talented kids everywhere, but the kids you're talking about probably come in to your high school less prepared, they have gaps, and so they don't do really well on these tests. But there is that potential there. So I think it's using a screener, it's doing school-based norms, and it's also looking for the creativity and the motivation and the other characteristics, not using that one single indicator, because it is going to preclude a lot of kids.
Use local norms. There's no excuse not to. New York City doesn't. And so what you get is one of the world's most diverse school districts, and their gifted programs are white and Asian. And you have entire neighborhoods that don't have a single identified gifted student. That is inexcusable in the year 2015. Use local norms. Doesn't make sense not to.
All right, we are, thank you. I'd like to take a minute to thank our distinguished panel, and really appreciate. As I said, if you walk out and you don't have a to-do, then you shouldn't have been in here. You always should leave with a to-do on something important topic like this, so
thank you. And I want to thank our moderator as well, Hanna Skandera.